Hello, thank you for joining me on the Empty Cup podcast. I'm your host, Ian Carlin. You are in the world where traditional and modern martial arts collide, and we dissect what is left over. And today with me via the internet, we have somebody who's been actually very, very influential on me in my recent developments in getting my ground game rounded out, and that is Professor Roy Dean. Professor, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me on, Ian.
I am elated for you to be here, and I like to start where I always start with my guests is, and I know you've probably shared this a bunch of times, but I would like you to share it again here if you don't mind, and that is, why don't you give us your own personal journey into the martial arts? How old were you when you got interested? What styles you took first, and what led you into Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu?
Yeah, so initially, you know, I always had a fascination with martial arts as a kid, but I didn't really begin training until I was 16 and I was sent to Japan as an exchange student. So I went as a Rotary exchange student, and they encouraged me to do a Japanese art after school. I could choose from a couple different things, but I ended up going with judo, and I really liked it. It was real, it was rough and tumble, it was a difficult martial art, but I got some good instruction over there. Through the competition system, I received my black belt or shodan in Kodokan Judo when I was 17, and I came back to the US, and I found judo wasn't quite the same, so I got more involved in Aikido. Mm. And then I decided to get serious when I was 21, and I moved into the dojo of a Japanese Jiu-Jitsu and Aikido master in Monterey, California. Okay. So I went Judo, Aikido, mm-hmm. then Japanese Jiu-Jitsu, specifically Seibukan Jiu-Jitsu. Mm-hmm. I lived in that dojo, established a live-in student program, continued to advance in that art. And then I ended up meeting Claudio Franza. He was one of the few authentic Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu teachers in Northern California. So I received my blue belt under him, and then eventually met Professor Roy Harris in San Diego, who led me from blue belt all the way through third degree black belt where I am today.
Okay. All right. Well, that's interesting. I got a couple questions about your own personal development. You went from like a style that would have been like almost full resistance, you know, in judo, where, you know, other than, of course, you got to learn the movement, but after you mm-hmm. actually learn the hip throw, when you're actually competing and you're grabbing the other person's gi, you know, there's a struggle going on there to a style that is basically seems to be almost 100% cooperative. Mm-hmm. How was that? How did you feel about that contrast?
It caused a lot of confusion because I was still a relative neophyte in the martial arts. I understood that there was a certain martial truth in judo because you go out there and, I mean, if you throw the guy, it's pretty decisive. And when you hit a throw with good technique and good timing, it can feel effortless. Yet you realized how many repetitions went in for that one effortless moment, right? Mm-hmm. Then when I transferred over to Aikido, it caused a little bit of concern because the effectiveness I was expecting in Aikido was not forthcoming when I would mix it up with somebody who, for example, didn't do Aikido, you know? Mm-hmm. Say a wrestler, and it was a little bit problematic to me. I didn't have enough experience to be able to contextualize like where the training method was failing. I thought I either needed to train harder, whatever that means,
do it more
intensely, I suppose, is what I thought at that time, or maybe I just need to do more repetitions because it takes like 10,000 repetitions in judo, and then you program your body and you're in movement and in a match, not thinking, and your body will spring into action. It will react for you. So I thought, okay, maybe I need to up the volume of training with Aikido in order to make it effective the way I imagined it would be, or I needed to train more intensely. Maybe training every class every day, which I did as an Uchideshi or live-in student down in Monterey, California. Or maybe I needed to do something that was more Aiki Jitsu, kind of the approach that Steven Seagal had where he was really doing very small spirals and very sharp turns with his Aikido.
Yeah. So did you find that working for you, or did you find it more like after, did you find pieces of it working in other situations? You know what I mean? So like, for example, yeah. The other night I was going against one of these white belts, and you know, I was talking to Stefan about this earlier. I don't know what it is with white belts, but they always have something to prove, you know? And I have a kind of an extensive background in Aikido as well. Mm-hmm. But I was going with this white belt, and like, I don't like practice Aikido anymore or anything like that,
sure.
But I went from a Kodagaishi to a Nikkyo, and I submitted him on Nikkyo.
Ooh, yeah.
But it's not like I practice Aikido, and then it was more like Aikido kind of came out during mm-hmm. a live roll.
Right.
Is that kind of, are you saying you practiced Aikido and that just completely carried over into Jiu-Jitsu?
Aspects of my Aikido training definitely carried over. The okay. ability to, like in Aikido, they train you on how to blend, how to go in, and then when your partner gets a better angle, gets some leverage on you, you go with it, but you stay connected. Mm-hmm. And by staying in that fight, so to speak, I think you gain a sensitivity, connecting back to your partner and really understanding your own balance, even if you're a little bit compromised, so you have a limb entangled or they're performing a joint lock on you. So I think the ability and the sensitivity that you build from being connected to your partner that whole time, instead of just bailing, which is what, you know, a person in a real situation would do, they don't stay connected. Mm-hmm. They try to separate immediately and reset. So I think that kind of sensitivity and blending adds a fluidity to my jiu-jitsu. But like I feel what happened with you is you had a lot of repetitions and training with that Kotokaiish and that transition into Nikkyo, and you happened to come up to an area that you were really familiar with, mm-hmm. right? So we were going from a grappling range where things weren't as clear, or maybe there was in this ground situation, and then boom, you locked on to this movement pattern and technique that you had done many times. So I think, you know, as you get more and more comfortable in jiu-jitsu, you can steer people toward those areas over and over again, where you can apply, you know, Aikido techniques or your own favorite technique. It's not really about the technique, it's more about the training method that allows you to herd people toward your strong suits.
Kind of funnel them down into it.
Funneling, yes, that's a great word.
Yeah. I've, you know, I'm connecting with a lot of what you're saying, particularly with my Wing Chun training, because I can read the body through the arms. Mm-hmm. I am connected to the person. You know, I haven't had to, believe me, I've had to learn a lot of stuff in jiu-jitsu. I mean, I'm barely a beginner, you know, just barely a blue belt, only like 3 months now into my blue belt. But there were certain carryovers that kind of helped me. And one mm-hmm. of the carryovers was that I was able to read balance through the connected hands. And yes. like you were talking about with the Aikido, able to stick with it, to blend with it. So as the person's mm-hmm. riding you or moving, I'm not like stopping it. I'm flowing with it and taking the other angle, you know, pulling and pushing rather than just going with it, rather than just trying to force them down to the ground like a lot of beginners would.
Exactly. And that's a learned response. And I really feel that arts like Aikido allow you to allow a safe area where you can kind of extend that response, practice, and develop that skill. And something, it's really an amazing art as a training method to mm-hmm. get that sensitivity that you need. You know, one thing I've noticed in my own game as I've advanced is I will just hang out in a technique. If somebody's sweeping me, I'll go with it. I'll be swept until maybe the last minute where I catch my balance and they're overextended. Or you can maybe, if they sweep you, say hip bump sweep, you land on the ground, but you don't settle. You immediately move into that next move. So you add 10 or 20% to reposition yourself, which prompts them to reposition. So being able to trust being taken over and losing your balance for a second, I think these are valuable skills that arts like Aikido can give you.
Yeah. Yeah. And those skills are the ones that kind of transfer over and kind of, it's almost like getting a booster shot. You know, you still need to learn the actual techniques, but you have a little bit of a booster shot into your training.
Absolutely.
Now you talked about learning Japanese jiu-jitsu alongside with Aikido. Now, this is very interesting. Do you feel like that was kind of a bridge into Brazilian jiu-jitsu? Do you feel like the two kind of, that Japanese jiu-jitsu is somewhere in between Brazilian jiu-jitsu and Aikido?
I actually do. I do feel that was not only in terms of technique. So you have Aikido, which is more regimented, more formalized, you know, limited palette of techniques. Morihei Ueshiba Sensei took away some of the techniques from Daito Ryu Aikido Jiu-Jitsu and kind of streamlined it, and the motions are metaphorical for, you know, conflict resolution and non-opposition to your partner. So it's a little bit pared down. Then the Japanese Jiu-Jitsu style that I studied came from Hakoryu, which is a sister art of Aikido, but they incorporate more pressure points, strikes, and also some in-between wrist locks that aren't necessarily Ikkyo through Gokkyo. So there are some of the techniques that were taken out of Aikido. Additionally, in their training method, they had kind of that middle ground of you have kata, and then you have sparring over here. But in between, they had henka, which was where people could do spontaneous attacks on you. And you were either confined to find a way to end in a particular technique, or you could just do whatever you wanted in response to those techniques. And so that was kind of a middle ground, not full resistance, but some spontaneity and some resistance. So I think that was a really fantastic bridge in terms of understanding like what it takes to do well when you go live.
Right, right.
You know, which I had already experienced in Kodokan Judo, but you know, I wasn't quite sure why I was effective in Judo. I mean, the idea of training method never really came to me until I discussed it with my instructor, Roy Harris, who emphasized that it was so much more important than the actual techniques themselves.
So what do you think your biggest challenge was now as I'm trying to piece this together? Because it's like, okay, judo is kind of has like a lot of aspects of jiu-jitsu and a lot of aspects that aren't jiu-jitsu. Aikido has aspects that are jiu-jitsu and a lot of aspects that aren't. And then you have this Japanese jiu-jitsu who has a lot of aspects of Brazilian jiu-jitsu and Americanized Brazilian jiu-jitsu, but aren't jiu-jitsu. Did you feel like when you finally got into jiu-jitsu that you were ahead of the game, or did you feel like there were certain challenges that faced you?
You know, I think I'd like to just maybe reframe. I feel all of those are forms of jiu-jitsu, kind of the parent art, but different specializations. Mm-hmm. You know, that with the standing to ground techniques of judo, the separated judo as a person's coming into you with Aikido. Although, and some Aikidoists don't feel that what they do is jiu-jitsu, it's more evolved, it's changed into something else. But I still consider it a form of jiu-jitsu. And BJJ is jiu-jitsu, but you know, different range of specialization. So yeah. I really feel that with jiu-jitsu in general, it tends to get more specialized and expertise flourishes in these specific realms. And when it comes to my difficulties, like going from art to art, part of it, of course, you're ahead when it in terms of learning how to be a good student,
right?
Knowing how to remain focused. I mean, I think these are more important than sometimes like the balance or the flexibility or the strength. You know,
right.
In some ways, they're at least on even footing there. Now, when it comes to, there were some balance and some sensitivity things, but I think one of the challenges was like letting go of my Aikido training and letting go of the Aikido Jiu-Jitsu training or the Japanese Jiu-Jitsu. like really putting on that other hat completely and learning BJJ as it was, as the teacher was presenting it. I think having that kind of separation in your mindset allows you to learn the art a little more cleanly, and then you can combine. I think if you try to combine that stuff too early, you might find one or two things, but I think that actually prevents you from really going deep into the heart of the art.
Oh, yeah, yeah. One of the, you know, my main big background probably is Jun Fanji Kundo. And the one of the, it's like a hindrance and a specialty, you know, it's like it's one of those things that are good and bad. You know, the whole idea of learn what's useful, you know, cut out what's useless to you and then add what's essentially your own, that kind of JKD motto we're all familiar with. But here's the thing. It's just like, okay, but you got to learn something first. Because I've had lots of students who, like, I'll be showing them a technique and they'd be like, well, I don't even think I'd use that. I'm like, well, you know, learn it first. Learn it first. And then you can decide whether or not it's something that's useful to you. And sometimes when you get, and it can be a good and bad thing when you have an eclectic background and you go into a new situation, you know, you can kind of go, oh, well, I should know this. You know, I don't know if I would do that. I mean, I've been doing judo. I've been doing this, you know, but at the same time you can go, oh, hey, look, you know what? Sweep my mind away. Everything that I can get out of this. And then those other things start popping back into place.
Totally. It'll happen on its own. They'll pop up.
Right. So I kind of wanted to have you on to talk about something specific, and that is the type of teacher that somebody out there can be. And I liked your analogy to learning a martial art is really like learning another language. And so could you kind of give that analogy, and then I want to break it apart a little bit
I'm so glad you asked that. Let's unpack that. Learning jiu-jitsu is like learning a physical language, and there are letters that you have to learn how to draw and basic movements. And then you put those letters into words. And I would say the words are at blue belt, and then you put them into sentences and really begin conversing with other people at purple belt. Okay, so blue is words, sentences at purple belt. Then you need to, you know, if you're being able to converse with somebody, they can have a comeback. So you need to go deeper. You need to go into an advanced argument. That would be brown belt. That's when you're really going into, like, you know, combination sets that are five or six techniques deep. And then by the time you reach black belt, it's more about being concise and cutting down, eliminating the unnecessary, you know, witty repartee, or maybe you have like a really quick comeback that shuts down their argument. And that's kind of the beauty of the black belt, where you can cut right to the heart of the matter and be minimalist in your response.
Yeah, very much so. So I analogized it to this. When I'm a, like, say I'm a, it's difficult for me because even though I'm, you know, I'm a blue belt and totally own that, I'm a total beginner when it comes to jiu-jitsu, and I love where I am. I love the evolution of it, but I've been in a lot of different martial arts. And so I kind of understand the mind frame of a more advanced student. And it doesn't matter what art you're in, you know, that from that brown to black, like brown belt is like when you've really kind of learned the language, but black belt is like when you've learned to leave out those things that still mark you out as a foreigner. So for example, like let's say I was a foreigner and I was learning English and I was talking to you, a brown belt would sound something like this. Hello, Professor Dean. How are you today? I am doing very well. Thank you very much. It's perfect, but it still marks me out a bit as a foreigner, where somebody who's a natural language person would say, hey, Professor Roy, how you doing today? You see, it's in what you leave out that kind of transitions you from that from that brown to.
I love it. I love it. I think that's really good. You know, and if I can riff on that for a second. Okay, so you have this. It's textbook language that you're doing, and you're proud of your textbook display. You know, every period, every T is crossed. So it's amazing, but it's so much more natural, pleasant, and efficient to be able to combine words, right? Where, you know, you're combining a bunch of words when you say, Professor Roy, you know, isn't it a beautiful day? Or, you know, is it not a beautiful day, Professor? So to be able to combine that, and that's what you're doing at Black Belt with your movements. You are combining. Now it takes a long time to be able to know the formalized movement and what's textbook and precise, and then be able to cheat and combine that to an increased efficiency. To be able to combine the choke into the arm lock, where in fact you're moving forward into the arm lock with that first hand because you know that other hand is coming up the block. You're not waiting for 1-2, you're combining it all. You're making it 1.5.
Right. I'm just going to write that down. That's awesome. So there are different, as I have been an instructor and as I've been a learner, and using this language analogy, there have been many different types of teachers, both having their pros and cons. Mm-hmm. So for example, if I was to teach you another language, there were some teachers who would just want me to start having conversations. They're just like, just go out and, okay, look, here's a few words. Go out and have a conversation. Okay. Now go out and have a conversation. Come back. Well, I didn't understand what he said. Okay. Let's just make up what you didn't understand. Let's go out and now have another conversation. Uh-huh. Or there are other teachers who are very much like, no, we are going to study this book on the English language or Latin or whatever, you know, and you're going to know, you know, every word. You're going to know, you know, whether it's a subject, verb, object language, or, you know, you're going to know this, you're going to know that. And they have you down there in that period a long time. And then maybe sometime later, you start to have sentences and conversations.
Mm-hmm. Right. So. Oh my God. These are so good. That's another great one. I think that was my approach to competitions for my students.
Okay.
I'm not going to put them out there in the realm of public debate until if they only know one or two words, because they're not going to be able to put those sentences together in the moment. You have to have at least a semblance of a game plan and the ability to communicate. Even if you only can make one or two or three points, okay, maybe that's the time you should start competing. When you actually have a path to the finish. I see some people that go into competition. I just feel as a blue belt, I went into competition and I didn't, it was a valuable experience, but I didn't know enough to be able to get to the finish, even if everything had gone well, you know? Mm-hmm. So I'm not going to put someone in the arena of public debate just being able to shout out a couple words. They need to have the ability to be able to make a point, even if it's simple, and even if they lose, it's fine. But they should have at least a fighting chance before I put them on display. Mm-hmm.
Now, do you find that you've taught both ways in the past, or do you do a lot more like textbook learning first before you want them to go to conversation?
You know, with rolling as a training method, my classes were 45 minutes of technique, which amounted to, you know, some light drilling in there as well. And then, you know, 30 minutes of sparring to 45 minutes of sparring. So you have kind of the kata or the textbook version, and then you have the live, you know, so it's a nice balance. But I do feel it's critical to be able to put in that textbook learning and to be able to reserve some space for that, especially in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. You need to learn positional escapes. You gotta know how to escape from the mount and from side control. And headlock is also important as well. So that's one reason it's in you know, for example, blue belt requirements. If you are demonstrating with people, I know this from firsthand experience, out in the real world, you know, if you're trying to show them the effectiveness of jiu-jitsu, especially at like a blue belt level, people will grab your head. And now a really educated jiu-jitsu student is not going to grab your head and just squeeze it, because it really doesn't serve the purpose of being able to submit. It's just a mobilization and annoyance, right? And plus, a good jiu-jitsu guy can just slip it off and go to the back. But the uneducated person that you're trying to share jiu-jitsu with out there, you should know how to escape that stuff. So headlock escape, side mount escape, mount escape. I feel like that will make the live sparring portion much more fun. And those are difficult things to learn with resistance. You need that graduated textbook training method leading into live training.
You know, I think a lot of it too, and this just kind of occurred to me, is the type of language you're trying to learn. So like there are some languages which are much more difficult. And there are some languages which are much easier. And that doesn't mean that they're better or worse. So for instance, boxing doesn't have as much of the technical aspect of, say, jiu-jitsu. You know, you've got like what, five moves, jab, cross, hook, uppercut, and you know, maybe overhooks and that kind of thing. And the rest of it is, you know, timing, distance, rhythm, that kind of thing. So in a style like that, you're going to, with the analogy, you're going to be spending a lot more time in conversation. Where if you're learning, say, you know, like you're trying to go from English to Russian, you know, which is a more difficult, a bulky of a language. Let's say you're going to try to learn jiu-jitsu. You know, it's not just a jab, you know, just to do the arm bar, you know, let's say from the guard position, you have to know how to angle the body, grab the sleeve, grab the collar, make sure you're biting down with your calf on the back, you know, and then come up. So one move in jiu-jitsu is more technical than, say, one move in boxing, and therefore probably in jiu-jitsu you're going to spend more time on the textbook a little bit more, you know.
There I agree with most of what you said, but I'm not sure that just because it has a more technical a wider technical palette, and it is a much, much wider technical palette. I don't know if it is going to be more technical than boxing, because sometimes when you put on specific constraints on an art, other aspects emerge where you have to go deeper. For example, with wrestling, you know, I feel wrestling is they confine the rules. They have a specific objective with the pins and variations of exposing the shoulders to the mat that you can get rewarded for. But it's the compression of the time frame that leads to different goals and kind of a different rule set. And I feel that with boxing, I think at the highest levels are all equally technical. Like, you know, at the world-class level, they're probably analyzing a lot of film and a lot of strategy, even though they are confined to just, you know, under 10 fundamental techniques. But then, you know, your specific combinations you drill for an opponent versus somebody else, you know, I'm not totally sure, but I am in total agreement that it is a much, much wider technical palette. And it requires a more, like a different approach to learning. I think, there's a phase in jiu-jitsu where you want as much input as possible, because like almost anything will make a difference in your survival, right? In those first couple years, you're searching hard for like, okay, well, what is really going to help me? Would this help me? Would that help me? And I think jiu-jitsu encourages kind of the unexplored options. Whereas boxing is not really, there aren't that many more pockets to get the unexplored angles and options.
Right.
You know,
right.
You know, when was the last time there was a revolution like, well, you know, I don't know. I don't know enough about boxing, but for example, the leg drag and barambolo in jiu-jitsu.
Okay.
That was a shift in the competition game when people started adopting that because people weren't ready for it. And then those guys are killing with it. I'd be curious to know about boxing and if there's been some kind of like technical shift like that.
I think the main thing I was getting at is not I think we're on the same page. It's a broader technical palette.
Yes.
And of course, yes, you go, when you get a smaller technical palette, you can still be as technical. You just go thinner and deeper.
Yes. Precisely.
Yeah. But I'm just talking about the way you learn. I'm talking about the way you learn. The way I think because there's not the wide technical palette in boxing, the way you learn in boxing is through more conversation. Mm-hmm. Where the way you learn in jiu-jitsu might have a lot of conversations, but it might be more at the base level. Might be more, okay, make sure you're pulling that sleeve into here, not here, you know, here.
Yeah.
You know, here.
Right. Yeah. I definitely see what you're saying. And it's true. There's so many positions where you have to you're not ready for conversation. You have to go through just non-resistant repetitions to just familiarize yourself with this new, you know, angle. For example, like rolling for omoplata or, you know, all these different areas where in boxing it's just right there.
Right. And boxing, I didn't mean to take away the technical aspect of boxing at all. Yeah. I was only trying to say the actual movement. So this kind of occurred to me as we were talking, because I've been in a barrage of systems and have been a teacher. We're all trying to strike that balance. You know, we're all trying to strike the balance of, I mean, the goal of martial arts training is to have the other person in conversation. And so we're all trying to strike that balance between, you know, learning the technical part and actually dialoguing and debating. Mm-hmm. But we tend to, I know I do, I tend to lean one side more than the other. And I know that there are problems on each side. When you're always technical, then the guy goes to a live training, he might not know what it's like to be in resistance. So but when you're always going, you know, conversation, or, you know, roll, this person over here might be able to keep up, but he doesn't actually even know how to put like maybe an arm bar on correctly because he never learned this over here. You know what I mean?
100%. That, you know, when you have more of an emphasis, I feel, on having continuous conversations and more on sparring, you tend to rely on a few things that work early for you. Your game isn't as well developed. It doesn't develop as evenly as it might if you establish kind of a more well-rounded technical foundation. Even if you don't use those, you understand those movement options and that you do have options. Because if you end up with kind of a limited game, you're like, okay, these angles are working for me. I have a really explosive bridge. I use the bridge all the time. Eventually you'll get better and better at it. You'll really get good at the timing and you'll put, I think almost every guy does this, where they just max out their power down that pathway. They're like, well, I'll just get as strong as possible. And then, but you can never win that. You always have to have another option, preferably going in the other direction, which will feed your first technical option, which is your A game, escape.
Right. You know, I'm already noticing, you know, in my own development that I'm running into situations where I start, you know, doing my high percentage moves.
Yeah.
And so for instance, when I get in half guard, a lot of times it works for me. And it's like, okay, I'd like to explore other options, but when I'm rolling, this works for me. One of the things I do is I go from putting on the Americana to moving the person's knee off of my knee to go into full mount. And I play this game where, okay, I go to the knee to push the knee off. The person starts paying attention to their legs. I go for the Americana. The person starts playing with the Americana, I start going for the knee and I get one of them. You know what I mean? I just kind of go back and forth and get one. But then I find myself being stuck because that's all I'm doing. You know, I'm like, okay, it's working for me, but that's...
It's good, but you need to add on. So you have like, you have a sentence, but you need to make a paragraph out of that. So, right. You know, when you have the underhook and you're in half guard and you're playing with that far arm or that knee, you know, now the next thing is you need to, if you're not already, you need to be able to, okay, so you're sweeping to the backside, to your backside. Mm-hmm. You need to be threatening that old school sweep where you take them back. Okay.
Okay.
And then when they react to that, you have to be able to come up to your knee and dogfight. So you have the threat of the submissions, the threat of the off balancing and changing positions. So yeah, you might be stuck there now, but you're finding something that works for you, and now you're encountering more resistance because your training partners get hip to that.
Yeah, right.
So now you need to add and develop that strength even more, mm-hmm. incorporating the sweep to the fore and aft. You know, you need to be able to mix the submissions in with the kazushi, with the off balancing that they can't help but respond to.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm in this classic blue belt phase. I see it from two perspectives. I see it from one, just being in it. But then as being an instructor in other styles, I'm noticing it. I have much more of an epistemological awareness of where I'm at.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's a matter right now of, okay, I've amassed these techniques. I've demonstrated these techniques. Okay, arm bar, triangle, hip sweep, escapes, you know, escape from mount, escape from, you know, that got me to my blue belt.
Yes.
But now what I'm trying to do is trying to add those techniques in the role. And there are sometimes, I'll tell you what, Professor, there are sometimes where I've been so frustrated because it's just like, it's not mine yet. You know what I mean? I'll get out of a role and I'll be like, why did I not use that triangle right there? It was a perfect setup. Why didn't I use it? And because it's not, you know, it's not mine yet. You know,
it's not yours. It's not yours. And it takes a deep level of programming. I'm telling you and that's one of the reasons why I'm kind of adamant about expressing to the Aikido community the benefits of basically drill to win. You know, you need to be able to drill these techniques, and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu has shown me once again, it's about repetition. And then that's got to be the baseline. It's got to be the baseline. Even conceptual understanding is anchored in solid technique that goes from one technique to the next without any interruption, you know. And you have to do that through drilling. You know, one technique here, okay, you understand the technique. Boom, another technique here. Initially, okay, it's good to know your neighbor, but you got to get your houses closed. Like this, you know, so it's smoothly stepping from one technique to the next. That black belt, you know, making a contraction with the words, we're overlapping.
Right, right.
So you can be advancing your position, setting up a submission, and pinning them all at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You're really combining all your efforts.
Right.
But that can be really frustrating to understand where you're at, but at least you're not lost. You just know you're in the middle of something that you can't get out of immediately, but you keep soldiering on, you know, and just drill. So it becomes second nature to you and you own it.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. I'm going to run something else by you too and get your advice. I'm going to make this very selfish. I'm going to make this a very selfish program. It's almost like a private lesson for me. And if anybody else gets any value out of it, that's great. But it's secondhand. I got my professor here, Roy, is going to teach me. So I've had a recent shift in my perspective in jiu-jitsu, and I didn't even realize that I had it. And that is that I'm so informed by my other styles that when I came to jiu-jitsu, a lot of my game was simply not getting submitted.
Uh-huh.
You know, that was like a big deal for me, just because I'm thinking, okay, I'm a stand-up martial artist for the most part. That's what I've been in since I was 7 years old. And what I'm realizing is that, okay, that mind frame is only getting me so far. I'm always on the defensive, and you know, I'm playing a fairly good defensive game, but I'm not sinking any techniques. And it just kind of occurred to me, just like, wait a minute, the best defense is a good offense. You know, if I want to be good on the ground, if somebody takes me to the ground in the street, I need to be able to sink a technique fairly quickly. And it's just been kind of frustrating for me to realize that at this point.
It's part of the game. It's okay to be, I mean, initially you get submitted, your marker of progress is not getting submitted. Mm-hmm. Then eventually it's submitting people like with less experience, then with the same amount of experience, then your marker is more experienced people. And then as you get more advanced, it's all about how you do it. You're going to submit them, but how many times you do it, or you know, how did you use too much energy, right? So you'll never be satisfied. Mm-hmm. Right now, you'll never be satisfied entirely with your game. So you're a little bit frustrated now. Hey, welcome to third degree black belt. You're still a little bit frustrated, like, oh man, I use too much energy or whatever, you know. So that's one aspect. So I wouldn't fret too much on that. Now, when it comes to you know, developing your game, and I lost my train of thought. Then could you
that's fine. I was just wondering for some advice for me in my next step. It's trying to be a little bit more offensive.
Yeah. Okay. So that is a great way to indicate progress, but ultimately you need to open up your game and make yourself more vulnerable for two reasons. One, when you allow yourself to get submitted, you really understand how they set it up and you remember it, right? Like, oh my God, for that Darce, as soon as you scoop my head, I couldn't get out. I need to scoop that head and secure it before, you know, so those kinds of things where you really feel the person applying the technique to the full extent, and then you internalize those mechanics, the things that you weren't able to do. And then when you understand, okay, so that informs you. So if you really wanted to avoid a Darce choke, you have to learn how to do a Darce choke. Because every step that they do in order to get that choke, you have to learn how to unwind to block those critical steps. So that's one reason to allow yourself to be submitted, so you can really understand how it works when it's applied to you. Number two, sometimes you can't just off balance somebody and allow them to give you an exposure. Like they're too strong, they're too whatever. You have to attack to get a response. So sometimes the off balancing is an attack, and you have to have attacks that you believe in that will sell the other person that they're actually in danger, and then they need to give you that other exposure. So it's good to get more aggressive, not to be a dick, but to be able to take your partner's mind, and then you can start to guide the conversation again. It's hard if you're just defending yourself. You need to be able to lead that conversation.
That's a good way to put it, leading the conversation. I think that's probably where I'm lacking, and kind of almost lacking intentionally, just because I'm thinking defensive. I'm thinking, oh, if I get taken to the ground, I will have to learn how to do this.
It's a good way for a while, but then you will eventually grow dissatisfied with your own jiu-jitsu game.
Yeah.
And you might be there already, like, man, I want more. Mm-hmm. But if you want more, you have to sacrifice. Mm-hmm. And you have to be a little bit vulnerable to turn that weakness into a strength. Mm-hmm. And your strength in not being submitted is actually a weakness, because it's limiting your ultimate growth. So just something to think about.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you very much. And where do you think strength plays in on this? I did a vlog a while back, and I'll kind of run my idea by you, and I want to hear what you have to say about this, because Sometimes I get, I'm a fairly, you can't tell it here, but I'm a fairly thick guy. I'm, you know, an ectomorph body type or an endomorph body type. I'm sorry. You know, I'm fairly round when I'm out of shape. I'm fairly square when I'm in shape. And I have a lot of natural strength.
Sure.
And, first off, I've been like number one, it's been commented on me that I'm strong. And number two, some people have accused me of using too much strength. Now, a couple of things. Number one, I have to totally admit there have been times where I've literally bench pressed somebody off of me from side control who, you know, weighed half my weight, right?
Insane.
You know,
sometimes you gotta do it.
And then the other thing sometimes people, I am strong, but I think sometimes people misread what I'm doing for strength. Because of the Wing Chun training, I have the ability through the arm to notice these micro breakdowns over a short period of time and take advantage of them. So I can literally work somebody's arm down to the ground. Oh, and so sometimes people think that I'm just pushing it down, but I'm really not. But the other thing is sometimes I do use strength. You know, sometimes I'll grab a collar or I'll shove the arm under the person's back and then shove the leg off of me. And, you know, I thought about this. I'm like, okay, I don't want to be that person who's only using strength, but strength's an attribute like speed. Like if somebody used an arm lock, they got a quick arm lock on me, I wouldn't go, well, you don't use your jiu-jitsu, you're just using speed. That's an attribute. You know what I mean? Strength is an attribute.
Of course.
It needs, yeah.
It fuels the techniques. And it's an important part of the game. Basically with jiu-jitsu, you can't have any weak links in the chain. You need to be strong enough. You need to be able to, you know, lift yourself up, lift maybe somebody else, maybe not their entire body weight, but you need to be able to manipulate another person's body without collapsing. Your structure needs to be strong enough to support various positions that you're going to assume, you know? Mm-hmm. And as you get better, you rely less on your muscular structure and more on your skeletal structure. Mm-hmm. And you can kind of relax into that a little bit more, but it's not like, but sometimes you got to initiate a little bit of movement, and sometimes it takes energy. Okay. So yes,
right.
Strength is necessary. However, strength and speed degrade over time. Mm-hmm. And you can always improve your timing, your sensitivity, and your awareness. You can increase those for 50, 60 years, mm-hmm. but you know, and I understand because I've gone through many, many different strength training regimens over the years. You know, I've had every kind of exercise device, and ultimately, right now I just do jiu-jitsu and Ashtanga yoga, and I just don't feel that getting that extra 10% increase in strength or that extra 10% in my performance is worth it. Versus just being flexible, having good range of motion, and being relaxed. Now, I happen to have a lot of answers technically, so that I don't need to, the answer isn't in strength for me. It would be nice to be a little bit stronger. You know, I have kettlebells and I do a little bit of working out. But you will plateau with the strength. You can continue it for a while, you can get incredibly disciplined, but eventually you'll meet that guy who's just bigger, stronger, no matter how strong you are. But can you do that on somebody who weighs 50 pounds more, 60 pounds more?
Right, right, right. It can't be strength alone, but strength is an attribute. You know what I mean?
Yeah, strength is an attribute, and some attributes, you know, you need to have a well-rounded attribute base. Mm. You know, you need to know how to, in real life, you need to know how to explode. How to, you know, explosion, sensitivity, timing, flexibility, but you know, the whole list. You need to be good in all of those. But but with jiu-jitsu, you don't need to be as strong. And I encourage you, it's actually a blessing when you kind of hit that wall with strength. Mm-hmm. Because necessity is the mother of invention. You will find a way around their strength. Mm. So it's good to do. But if you can do strength training in conjunction with some kind of mobility work, I would recommend that even more. And ultimately, dude, I have to fight black belts that are like, I'm like 190, they're 260, Division I wrestler, prison guard. You're not moving him. Right. You're not moving him. You know, you have to learn how to go around.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
And you'll meet that.
I've heard it that it, I heard it said this, and I don't exactly remember where it was said, but I heard somebody say one time that you can make it to a pretty good ranking, depending upon how, you know, the instructor ranks you on your strengths, but you can't make it to black belt unless you address your weaknesses.
100%. That is so true. And a lot of people, you know, at purple and brown, at purple belt, you have a pretty, you can do jiu-jitsu. You know, it's pretty powerful. You know technique combinations, you can tap people, you can use your legs, you can use momentum and combinations, and you make it, that it starts really getting fun. Just wait, keep going. But by the time you reach purple, it starts really getting fun.
Oh yeah. I'm a dedicated student here, by the way. I've been, I love it. You know, I'm probably there. Let's see. I'm there three times on Monday. I'm there once on Tuesday and then another two times on Wednesday. So, I mean, I'm going to jiu-jitsu like a lot right now. I'm older and I started late. So I want to get there, you know, get as much training in as possible. As long as I've got the time, I'll go. 'Cause I love martial arts and stuff. So yeah, there's nothing that's going to beat that time. You know, that time, you got to put in the time.
Time on the mats. I'm telling you, it's time on the mats. And I am still putting in time on the mats. I train, I teach. I still put in time on the mats because you have to. It's
right.
A perishable skill. I mean, you'll always have some amount of skill, residual skill, but to really have a dialed in game, you need to be on the mats regularly.
Okay. Couple more questions for you. And when I was a teacher, and then I also do this with myself, encouraging myself to do this, I like to spar or roll with all levels of people when I go. I try to roll with the person who is, you know, the brown belt, black belt. I try to roll with the person who's, you know, around the blue, you know, high white belt. And then I try to roll with the white belts as well. And I do it for a variety of different reasons. I find myself being tested in different areas when I do this. What do you think about that strategy? What do you think somebody who's about where I am, blue belt range, you know, what do you think I'm going to get out of rolling with a black belt, rolling with a blue belt, rolling with a white belt?
I think all of each group is critical to your success. It's nice to have the upper belt to roll with. That is probably the least critical to your long-term success, is actually being able to roll with, say, a black belt. Mm-hmm. You can get better without having that black belt, but man, it is nice when you have that black belt. On the other hand, you have to realize there's a huge gap in between where you are and they are, and you can't really let yourself entertain the fantasy of like how you do against them, because it's how they let you do, you know, against them. So when it comes to rolling with people at your level, you need that. Those are the battles. Those are where people will really go hard. When you're trying to throw on that triangle and have to switch to an arm lock, you really need to do it, because that person doesn't want to tap to you. That's your brother. Those are your best training partners. You know, they are making you tighten up your timing and showing you the necessity of drilling from technique to technique, so it's super smooth. In the competitive roles, you can actually pull it off. The white belt, that's for you. That's for you. That's for you to feel good. That's for you to maybe teach them a little something. But you know, blue belt, I wouldn't worry about that too much. It's more of for your enjoyment, and for you to practice and get confidence in your arm bar or your A game. You're starting to assemble your A game right now.
Right, right.
When it comes to a black belt or a really good upper belt, it's not really about how you do against them in terms of passing their guard or in terms of, you know, getting to a specific position. It's more about observing how they off balance you, how effortless and light you feel if they sweep you, mm-hmm. you know, how controlled yet blocked in you are when they are, for example, they're mounted on you and applying a choke. You know, it's not herky jerky. It's like storm clouds coming over you. It's mm-hmm. steady, it's dark, and you're gonna get what's coming. And there's not really that much you can do to stop it. So when you can't stop it, don't get up from the roll and say, I knew you were gonna do that arm lock and there was nothing I could do to stop it. Because he knows. He knows, right?
Right, right.
It was more of, that was great. How did that happen? Mm-hmm. And he'll show you the combination, and he'll relive that pressure sequence. Mm-hmm. And I want you to internalize that and say, okay, that's a good combination. I need that. And the feeling of what's possible with a playful, high-level jiu-jitsu game. Mm-hmm. But the real battle is with people at your own, at like a blue belt, or the people at like a high blue, you know, that are almost at the cusp of purple. Well, those are the battles.
Those are the battles. That's where, if you, on your recommendation, I should be spending a majority of my.
You need to, but yes, I think you need to spend the majority of your time, you know, kind of sharpening the blade against those people. But do get in. You know, I would say it's probably 40% against people at your level, 30% white belts, 30% upper belts.
Okay. All right. Sounds good. Sounds good. Sometimes I roll against the white belts because you don't know what you're going to get, you know, there, you know, if you're going to get this guy who's just came from, you know, his wrestling background, and he's going to try to pin you down with all of his strength, and, you know, and then sometimes there are people, they're just like, oh, you know, you throw him in an arm bar and like, you know, a couple seconds, you're like, well, I didn't know it was going to be that easy. But you know, the white belt is actually what you're going to encounter on the street. You know what I mean? That's going to be kind of what the unknown. You know what I mean? It's like, absolutely. I don't know what I'm going to get. It's the wild card, so to speak.
You are so right. And I have been injured. I mean, I usually don't roll with white belt sometimes, occasionally, mm-hmm. but most of the time it's because you don't know what you're going to get. So pro tip for assessing, you need to assess the white belts before you roll with them, especially as an older guy.
Yeah,
you need to see it. It is cool to just be like, oh, what's this going to be like? But you should start doing an initial assessment. Okay, what does the guy look like? What's his neck look like? Mm-hmm. What do his ears look like? You know, what's his overall physique? Does he look like a judo player? Mm. Does he look like he wrestled? Does he look like a guy who's been studying 10th planet techniques, you know, in his basement for the last 10 months? And then I would recommend you observe him roll one time. Look at his tendencies and then strategize. Like, oh my God, he pulls half guard every time. I must avoid that. Mm-hmm. So as a brown belt, it's so much more about strategy. It's mm-hmm. so much more about doing reconnaissance, looking, seeing their tendencies, going to your strengths, countering their strengths, and being able to assess exactly, and that goes into movements as well. You know that guy's gonna have a strong explosive ridge if he's a wrestler. Right. You don't want to get to Kesagatame if he's a judo player. That's where you spend your energy. He's trying to grab your head and take you down to the ground. You shuck that tricep, you get to his back.
Right.
You spend all your energy there because ultimately you'll spend a lot less energy than trying to get out of that headlock or that Kesa position.
Right.
Yeah, seriously, you can never start reconnaissance too early when you're assessing your opponents.
Right. Well, thank you, Roy. We have one final question I ask all my guests, and that is, what are your top three training methods? And or if you would like to switch that out for fight tips, please share that with our audience.
Number one training method is learn how to do ukemi. Ukemi shows you how to protect yourself if you fall or get thrown. Mm-hmm. And in real life, you don't have time to figure it out in the moment. right? You need to instill that into your body beforehand. Okay, so that's fundamental. If you don't have good rolling and falling skills, you could pay a price later. So number one, and that also enhances your kinesthetic awareness and your ability to understand where you are, upside down, et cetera, et cetera. So good ukemi skills or falling mm-hmm. skills. Number two, drill to win. If you really want to have a smooth, unbroken response in the physical debate with your partner, you have to drill two and three technique combinations, arm lock, triangle, arm lock, you know, kimura, guillotine, hip bump. All of those things need to be drilled, and you need to find a training partner that's willing to drill and not just roll every time you get together. Number three, be patient with yourself. It's not a sprint. It's a marathon. You may have years where you're doing jiu-jitsu consistently, you're seeing great progress, and then you might, life happens, you know? You might get 6 months off, you might get injured. Just be patient with yourself. Be consistent. Keep your mind in the game. Keep your consciousness in the game. Watch videos. Do what it takes to stay involved and integrated with the art. And ultimately, in the long run, you'll come out ahead.
All right. All right. Thank you. Let people know where they can find you online.
Yeah, absolutely. You can go to roydean.tv. I have a number of resources there. I have a store with digital downloads. I have apps for both Android and for iPhone. And I also have a subscription channel, roydean.vhx.tv, where I put everything I've done and all of my new projects up. And it's pretty impressive. The technology is great. It's through VHX, which was recently acquired by Vimeo. Solid technology, and I think really a leading edge presentation for the art of jiu-jitsu.
Excellent, excellent. And let us know if there's any time you have a new product out and you want to hawk it on this on my site. You know, let me know. You're always welcome to come on and talk with us here. Stay with me here, Roy, if you don't mind. I'm going to close out the show, but just stick with me just for a second. I'd like to talk with you just for just a minute afterwards, if you don't mind. Thank you, everyone. This has been the Empty Cup Podcast. I've been here with Professor Roy Dean. Hey, go on over to his site and purchase some of his stuff. I mean, the guy has a wealth of knowledge, and let him know that you were sent there by the Empty Cup Podcast. And if you like what you heard, please do us a favor, share this on your favorite social media, and go to iTunes or Stitcher Radio. Leave us an honest review. It helps people find the show. You're always welcome to follow us at Facebook.com/EmptyCupPodcast and on Twitter @EmptyCupPodcast. And I have my own YouTube site as well, where I offer my own fighting tips and some vlogs and things like that. So if you're interested in learning some Ronin JKD, where I do groundwork on that channel as well, and stand-up work and Wing Chun and all that good stuff. So head on over there and subscribe, Ronin JKD. And thank you so much. And until we meet again, please don't forget to keep your gloves up.